It's an absolute honor to be here. So I want to thank you, Sarah, and everybody at Six Degrees for inviting me to be here today, because it truly is an honor to be in front of so many spectacular women, firstly. So Sarah, what a fabulous job of my bio. Thank you. I class myself as a multi-passionate entrepreneur and a self-love advocate. And I'm really proud to stand in front of all of you today and be able to say now, I love me. I love who I am. And if I was to go back even a year ago and think that I would be saying that in a room full of women being filmed, I would have cringed. So if you are sat there in your seats thinking, oh, this is cringy, I get it. That would have been me a year ago, definitely 2 years ago. And there would have been two things stopping me from being able to say that. The first would be, even though I was actually quite put together, I did personal growth, I read all my self-help books, you know, I was a functioning human, I did not like who I saw in the mirror. I really did not. And like looking back now, I just find it so sad. But the second reason is because I would have worried so much about what you would have all thought, how you would have judged me, what you would have said to each other and whispered to each other. Oh gosh, she loves herself. Look at her. You know, she only cares about herself. And it really would have bothered me. But the reason why I'm so passionate about talking about self-love and self-worth is because when you truly like who you are and you know who you are, you know what you stand for, the opinions of others really do become irrelevant. They don't matter anymore. And if you take one thing from tonight, I hope that it's that. When you truly tune in to who you are, what you stand for, and why people like you, want to be around you, then really the opinions of others, they can't touch you. They still hurt sometimes, don't get me wrong, but that hurt, that frustration, that lasts for far less than when you don't know who you are and you don't love who you are. So to me now, self-love is about being kind to myself regardless. Regardless of what I look like, regardless of what it says on the scales, regardless of the mistakes I make, the things I say or do that put someone out or are taken the wrong way, or if I do make a genuine like cringe fail or faux pas, I can move on. It's not that I don't take responsibility, because I 100% do, but I now have an awareness where I can take that on, I can learn from it, I can grow from it, and I can accept and let go. And when you're able to do that, for me, that's what true self-love is, that regardless of what is going on around you and what you look like, you can still say, I like me. You can still be kind to yourself. We're everyone in this room, I'm sure, is super kind to everybody, but perhaps not to themselves. So it doesn't mean that if I do get criticism, it doesn't hurt. Of course it does. But I'm able to move on because I know who I am and I like who I am. But to get to this point, I have to have several pretty serious rock bottoms, which I'm going to share with you tonight. And I'm going to share with you my story before I kind of get to the top tips of self-love, because I feel it's so important to know the context. And I hope that you guys, if any of it resonates with you, you can look at me stood here today and think, gosh, if she can love herself, I can. And if one person goes away thinking that, my job is done. And I'm super, super happy. So hindsight is an amazing thing, I've realized. Isn't it funny? I realize now that drama school, so that's where it all began, drama school and my acting career actually laid the foundation for self-loathing. Absolutely fabulous. Nobody puts that on the prospectus of drama school. And, you know, to start off with, there were 2,000 female applicants for the drama school I wanted to to go to, which was one of the top three at the time. It's called the Drama Center. It's now nicknamed the Trauma Center, just to give you an idea. But 2,000 girls applied and there were 10 places. There were 20 places for boys, but they only took 10 girls because they knew that even then, when I trained, there were far less options, parts, roles for women. So they didn't want to train a whole load of women to then not get employed, basically. So the competition was so, so tough. And with that level of competition, what comes with that is, of course, comparison. Comparison of everything. What length my legs were. They're not long. I used to put 5'3" on my CV. I'm 5'2". You do whatever it takes to be what they want. You know, people with longer hair, more beautiful hair, more prettier than me, thinner than me, better at singing, better at dancing. You just zone into everything you don't think you are. And I don't think that's unique to performing. I think actually, we as humans, as women, can tend to do that, and it's just so damaging. So rather than acknowledging the achievement of being one of 10 that got in, because I did, I focused on my perceived flaws, on my not good enoughs, on the things that needed improving to progress in my performing career. And this is one important thing that I want to kind of highlight to all of you, is that if you don't take time to log your wins, to log the compliments, to log the successes, what happens is that every rejection, every setback, every mean thing or comparison becomes all-consuming because you actually have no counter-narrative. You have no evidence that you're not those things, that you can't move forward. And so when we focus on our perceived flaws and our not good enoughs, it's so much harder to bounce back and to become resilient when times are hard. And as an actress, you know, no's and rejections are part of the course. It's normal. We all know that. It doesn't mean it's not hard and it doesn't hurt. So they say, in the performing world, but I think it's actually quite true in just everyday life. Within 3 to 10 seconds of meeting someone, that you get a sense of them and they know whether they want you or not. And for me, like in a way, I was like, well, that's great because that means that it's not judged on my acting ability. So, because I generally haven't said a word by then other than, hello, I'm really excited to be here, you know, all that stuff. So that's great. You know, it's no judgment on my performing ability, but what it is judging me on is me in those 3 to 10 seconds, what I look like, my height, my weight, whether I'll fit in a costume, whether my face fits, whether my voice is annoying, whether, you know, how I stand up against everybody else. And that is so damaging because that's me. That's me they're judging. It's me. Like, that's why I didn't get some of the roles that I went for. So then I go into change mode, right? I'm going out to buy lots of audition outfits that I can't afford because that's going to be the difference. I'm going to go into John Lewis or wherever and get a whole new makeup regime because that's the problem. It's my face. I'm going to dye my hair. I'm going to cut my hair. I'm going to grow my hair, put extensions in. I'm going to lose weight. I'm going to put on weight. All the time, I was focused on being perfect for somebody else, not what I wanted to be and creating me. You know, there's the old cliche that performers are confident when they're being somebody else, when they're taking on a role. But it's so much more than that because it wasn't just the role I was changing. I was changing me for every audition I went for, which is crazy looking back. By this point, I was 24. I was touring Austria playing Lady Macbeth, a role that most actresses only dream of throughout their whole career. But did I celebrate that fact? No, of course not. I focused on lack. I focused on all the things that I was going to have to do to get audition ready again on day one of being Lady Macbeth of a 6-month tour. Absolutely ridiculous. But this is the mindset that I was in. It was like, right, well, what's my next job going to be? Before the one that I got was even started, really. So I had my dream role, but was I happy? No. I love performing. I'm passionate about performing. Absolutely love that. But was I wholeheartedly fulfilled, happy? No, because I didn't know who I was. And I honestly don't think until you like and you know who you are, which is what I kind of coach with young people that I work with, teenage girls especially, I don't think you can be truly happy because you haven't figured out what makes you happy because you don't quite know who you are yet. And that's all okay if that's where you're at. It doesn't take much to get to the point where you do. And so that's another kind of top tip that I'd like to share with you is that stop waiting for that dream role, dream promotion, dream husband, dream job, dream house, dream holiday to be happy. Because what you'll find is that those external things are not the things that will make you happy. It's the internal things. It's a knowingness that you're a good person. It's a knowingness that you're willing to go out there and be kind and be somebody that walks into a room and when you've left, people go, oh, I'm glad I spoke to her. You know, it's those things and spending time with family or friends or people you care about, people that lift you up. That is joy. That is happiness. And the external things are just kind of added sprinkles, which sometimes don't taste as good as you think they will anyway. So I decided, after not being as happy as I thought I would, being a performer, I met a boy who's now my husband, and he was in the army and he was going off doing cold weather training in Norway. I was in Austria. It was like, this is never gonna work. So I was kind of at a crossroads anyway, and I decided that I wanted to retrain to be a teacher. And so he was based in Devon. I was obviously in London performing, and the only training school to not have completed their application process was in Devon. Like, I was like, oh no, he's gonna think I'm weird. He's gonna think I'm following him. So I sent him the link to show him that it was the only one that hadn't taken all their submissions yet. And I said, what do you wanna do? And he was like, come down to Devon, we'll get a flat. If it doesn't work, it doesn't work. You're a teacher, I'm in the military, we tried. Thankfully, it did work, but I'm so glad that I took that opportunity. Anyway, I digress. So I left my agent, my acting agent, and was ready to start my PGCE. Then the BBC called. I was like, oh God, what is going on? If the BBC had phoned me like a year ago, I would have been absolutely thrilled to bits. And they were asking me, because Ryan was going to go to Afghanistan, your boyfriend's in the military. Would you like to be part of a BBC Two show with Gareth Malone to be in the Military Wives Choir? So I was like, yes, not really knowing how I was going to fit it all in, but said yes. And thank goodness I did, because we ended up with a platinum selling number one Christmas single. We recorded an album. We sang at Downing Street. We went on Graham Norton. We went, what else did we do this morning? The Millie Awards. Like, we did so many incredible things, but that's because my eyes were open to opportunity, regardless of the fact that I'd kind of diverted what I thought was my life career, which was performing. So that's kind of like another message, I guess, that I want to get out to you guys today, is that nothing is a waste of time. If you follow a passion or a hobby or something that lights you up, I promise you, if your eyes are open and you're open, you'll find ways to do it again, and it will find you. I mean, look at me here today on camera. I haven't been on camera for flipping years, but here we are with a microphone in front of all you incredible women. Like, you just never know when it's gonna come back. So Ryan, after I trained for taught for 5 years, Ryan got posted to Italy. So we decided that we were gonna move together because we were young enough, and I was pregnant at the time, but really early days. So we decided that we were gonna go and have an adventure for 2 years. And it was amazing. But the problem was, I'd given up my career again. And what had happened was, I hadn't realized that I wouldn't be able to get a job out there. Because I was pregnant, the Italians were like, no, pregnant women don't work. Go home, put your feet up. Don't eat mozzarella, it's dangerous. And that was kind of the spiel. No one would give me a job because I was pregnant. And it's great. You get to go at the front of the queue at supermarkets. Like, it's wonderful, but not if you want to work. So I felt, you know, lost for the first time since I was 15. I couldn't work. I didn't have purpose. I didn't know what I was doing. So already was kind of low. And then my friend emailed me. So I was 4 months pregnant at this time. And my friend, dear friend, emailed me. And she said, Emily, I'm really sorry, but you need to know that this email has been sent. So I was like, oof, what's this going to be? Opened it and saw the sent to list. And an email, a long email, had been sent to all my friends and family. Everybody on my Hindu list, which was long at the time, outlining all the reasons why I wasn't good enough for my husband. All the things that they felt I should be ashamed by, perhaps, but also just full of lies to try and paint my character into something much darker than I hope you see that it is tonight. And that was really hard. So me, the confident performer, all of a sudden couldn't breathe. So I was sat on a chair, pregnant, with no friends and family around me because we just moved to Italy, reading this email, panicking and not breathing. Luckily, because it was hot, all the doors were open, so I could shout. And the great thing about military networks is that they quickly become friends and become family. So the second that I shouted, one of my neighbors came, asked me what was wrong, and she could see that I couldn't breathe, and she helped me. And I ended up in hospital. And the guys at the hospital, they were worried that I wasn't safe at home, but because I couldn't breathe, I couldn't tell them that I was. So I just had to show them the email. And they, like me, were completely horrified. I'm sure every single person in this room has had something horrible said about them, which I'm sure was not true. But to see it in print and be able to reread it over and over again, and knowing that it was sent to everybody you care about, everybody whose opinion you cared about at that time, was devastating, completely devastating. And very quickly, I spiraled into severe depression. I had no purpose, no self-worth, no confidence. I was lost. And I honestly believe this email hit me so hard because of the fact that my whole life, I'd never taken the opportunity to congratulate myself on anything, to celebrate the wins, to log any compliment. I'd never done that. I'd always focus on the flaws and the not good enoughs. So this was kind of like the thing that just broke me, because I had no counter argument. I had no counter argument against all these hateful, hurtful words that were designed to turn everyone I loved against me. So even at my lowest point then, I knew that I needed to do something because my child was going to be born in 5 months. So I needed to get better. So that's when I received a call from a friend of mine asking me to join a network marketing company in health and wellness. On paper, I should have said no, and I should have just slammed the door, phone down, because like I was in a country they didn't sell the products in. I have no background in health and wellness or business or selling, and I had severe depression, but I honestly felt like, oh, I've got nothing to lose. Can't get any worse. So I said yes, and it was the best thing I could have done because all of a sudden I had this like rallying of cheerleaders around me, supporting me, telling me I was good at this, that they believed in me, that they hadn't received this hideous email. So it was like a fresh start. And direct selling is basically using products, liking them, recommending them, and teaching other people to do the same. So it wasn't rocket science, but I was good at it. And that really helped to boost my confidence. And by Monty's birth, because I had these women that rallied around me, because they'd introduced me to personal growth, personal development, self-help, because they had done that, I was well. And I could experience joy by the time Monty was born. And for that, I am eternally grateful. So I borrowed someone else's belief in me before I believed in myself. And I think, again, like, it's okay to do that. If you feel like an imposter at times, and you feel like, oh, I'm not good enough, or they think I'm better than I actually am, I'm going to get found out. Like, all of that is normal. You just got to check it and go back to that list of compliments and successes and wins and times that you've triumphed in your life so that you can move forward and you can borrow someone else's belief, just like I did. So I built a successful business online and was asked to train 3,000 entrepreneurs at the Birmingham NEC. So, knock, knock, there's my performing career again, like absolutely thrilled. And I loved that. I got so much out of giving back again, like I did when I was a teacher. But fast forward to January 2021, so last year, I kept getting nudges to kind of combine all my careers together. My acting, my teaching, my health and wellness, my mindset, and my story. And I created Small Steps, Big Vision. My mission is to champion young people to love who they are, know what is important to them, and to have the courage to say yes to opportunity. Because I really feel like if I had known the things that I'm teaching them, the course of my life would have been a bit happier and a bit more easy breezy. I don't regret any of it because here I am and all is good. But I don't ever want anybody else to feel like they are nothing, like they are lost, like I did. So I do this through workshops, and I get teenagers thinking about who they are, who they want to become, rather than just what they want to do. And it was all going really well, full steam ahead, until 2 weekends in a row, I realized what I was saying to myself about my body. We'd have two really joyful weekends where we were chasing waterfalls and like going and laughing, singing, like having a picnic, all lovely. And then I'd go to take my clothes off to go wild swimming, and then it would start. Oh my God, why have you done this? You're in a bikini, everyone's looking. They're all thinking, put some clothes on. Oh gosh, your legs are so white. Oh, there's cellulite everywhere. Oh, you are disgusting. That was what was going on in my head. Over and over again. So any joy that I felt was just squashed. It was diluted because of these feelings. And I hadn't realized I was doing it until my friend, who was training to be a life coach, she said to me, oh, can I use you for a training session? It'll be recorded and I'll be graded on it. Don't worry, we can talk about business. So I was like, yeah, great. Never one to turn down an opportunity. And then she's like, oh, how's your weekend? And I was like, it was okay, but... And then she said, tell me what you say about yourself. So I told her. And when I said the words out loud to somebody else, you are disgusting, I just burst into tears. And I cried for an hour on her training session that was being recorded. The poor thing. She got so much more than she bargained for, but she's a life coach now, so it can't have gone that badly. But one thing that she asked me was, okay, what can you do to move this forward? And so for me, there was only one name, and that was Gina Swire. She's recently written a book, but she is a self-love transformation coach. Now, whoa, that's woo-woo for me. I was like, woof. But I just felt like I need to do something so that I don't pass these thoughts, pass this negativity onto my children, my son and my daughter. Also, I'm sick of diluting my joy. So let's get going. So I signed up with her, and honestly, it was transformational. The title is deserving. So within 6 months, and still to this day, have never even thought a negative thought about my body. Never, let alone said it in my head or out loud. Does that mean that I absolutely love my cellulite? No. Does it mean I love my stretch marks? No. But I don't hate them. And when you don't hate something, you're not thinking about it. If you feel neutral about something, you're not thinking about it. I'm focusing on all the other things that I love about myself, I like about myself, the friends that I love, the family that I love, the adventures I love going on, rather than, oh gosh, bikini time again. And to be able to say that is so freeing, to not care anymore what people think. Because in reality, they're too busy thinking about themselves and probably what they look like in a bikini to even be bothered about you, even see you. It's so liberating. So instead, I focus on the things that I know that are good about me, that I do love about me. The wife I am, the mother I am, the friend I am, the colleague I am, and the good, the value that I'm adding into this world. And I encourage you all to do the same, because you are all adding value. It may not be in a business, but it may be at home. It may be with a friend that really needed you and you were there. On a daily basis, we can add value. And that is so fulfilling. That is the key to joy. So the opinions of others become completely irrelevant when you love who you are. And the things that help me are to forgive yourself for past things. We hold on to so much shame and like, oh, I wish I hadn't done that. Shame and regret. When you hold on to it and you don't forgive yourself for those things that have happened in your past, could be years ago, what happens is you've closed off any space left for joy, any space left for love or new experiences and new joy and new habits, because you're holding on so tight to those things that you perhaps are ashamed of. So forgive yourself for those things. Write them down. Set the intention to forgive yourself. Burn it if you have to, but get rid of it, whatever it takes. The second thing that really helped me on Gina's course was to find a photo of myself at age 2 or 3 and keep it somewhere that I'd see it a lot. So either in my wallet or in my journal, because when you see that younger version of you, innocent, sweet, not having experienced any of the rubbish that life can sometimes throw at us, you know, you see the innocence. We are all still those children. We've just aged a bit. But we are still that sweet, innocent, kind, loving, free spirit. And it's such a humbling experience to see that photo, that image of yourself, because you would never say those words to a 2 or 3 year old that we have on loop in our heads. The third thing is to celebrate the wins and log your compliments. Have an actual book. I don't care if anybody thinks you're big-headed. No one needs to see it, know about it. Have a book. Every time you get a compliment, put it in. Because on those days when it's more challenging and it's hard, you can go back to them and go, do you know what? No, it's all right, I'm good. Because sometimes it can be hard to remember. Be clear on what your version of loving yourself is. What does she look like? How does she stand? How does she talk to people? How does she move? How does she put on a swimsuit? How does she feel in that? Know what that means for you, how you'll feel, what you want to be, what you want to look like, what you want to have. Because if you don't know, you won't know if you're actually feeling it or not. And it's harder to get closer to that. And finally, don't punish yourself when that inner critic does come in or you do make a mistake. Because if you punish yourself for being a critic to yourself, it doesn't work. So you acknowledge it, you think, Oh dear, that's my inner critic being cute again. And you move on, you let it go and be your own best friend. So in those times when it is hard to love yourself, because we all have them, think, if I was my own best friend, what would I say to myself? And write yourself a letter. Sounds a bit woo-woo, but it works, because we would never talk to anybody else the way that we talk to ourselves. And your words are your thoughts, are your reality. So just to leave you, why discuss self-love and self-worth in a room full of spectacular, successful, sexy women? Well, because I honestly believe that self-love and self-worth is the secret key to success, joy, and fulfillment that we're all looking for. Because when you doubt yourself and when you don't love who you are, you listen to the negativity. And that is what stops you from going for that promotion, from going for that thing that seems too far out of reach, rather than just going, you know what, I'm going to give it a go. I believe in myself enough to give it a go and see what happens. And self-love and self-worth trickles into every single area of your life. You'll see it. When you love who you are, when you know who you are, your children see that. Your partner sees that. I'm so much nicer when I'm liking who I am. I'm so much more patient And you'll feel it, you'll see it, it's an energy. And when me here saying, I love myself to all of you, hopefully you won't feel so weird and cringy about actually just when you're by yourself, you don't need a platform and a microphone, but to say, do you know what, I actually do like me. I'm a good person, this is why. By talking about self-love and self-worth and promoting it, it allows others to do the same. And that, I think, is where we've got to get to. When we feel comfortable as women to celebrate ourselves rather than hide, that's where the magic is. So thank you so, so much. Thank you.